Buenos días. Estás con el Smithsonian Latino Virtual Museum. Good morning. You are watching the Smithsonian Latino Virtual Museum. And I am Dr. Xochitl Chavez here in Denver, Colorado, where we have a special cooking demonstration of bizcochitos. Here with...
Hi, I'm Ron Miera. I'm a Santero, and I guess I cook today.
the reason why I'm saying we have a special broadcast is, in addition to Ron being an artist, a Santero, he actually makes a bizcochito that he learned from his mother and grandmother's recipe, so he will be sharing that. But we are also in Denver, Colorado, in a particular place that has a long history here in the community. Could you tell us a little bit about CHOC?
CHOC, which stands for the Chicano Humanities and Arts Council, was founded over 37 years ago by a group of different Chicano artists and Latino artists that got together and decided to make a little co-op. And it's been around ever since.
And so, as you can see, we have lots of activities happening or visitors coming in and asking other artists that are here. And we actually have a kitchen here. So there's many types of educational programming happens here in this space. So without further ado, would you mind telling us, and how do we do bizcochitos?
Okay, well, anybody from the Southwest, especially New Mexico and Colorado, know what bizcochitos are. Bizcochitos are actually the state cookie of New Mexico. My mom and my grandmas and on both sides have always made bizcochitos. Like I was telling her earlier, is that my mom's recipe, she had it memorized. And when she did write it down, she just wrote down what went in it. Not so much, you know, how many tazos of this or that was in it. So I sort of had to figure that out and had to ask my aunties as to, hey, how do you make the bizcochitos? And I've been doing it ever since. Every Christmas I do this. Bizcochitos are not only made for Christmas, but for special events in the family. Weddings, funerals, any special event, you're gonna have bizcochitos there, especially in New Mexico. And there's many different variations of the bizcochitos. Everybody has their own way to do it. This is the way that my mom did it. So that's the way that I kind of do it, just to keep on that tradition. I made it many times here for bizcochitos here for CHOC, and I've also made them, you know, for family gatherings and that. So I guess we'll just go ahead and start cooking here.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you so much.
Okay, first thing you do is you get 6 cups of flour, white all-purpose flour, and to that you're going to add 5 teaspoons of baking powder. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then you're going to add a pinch of salt. My mom never used to use cups or anything to measure. She always used her hands like this, so that's about a pinch of salt, like my mama used to do.
And you also said that your grandmother would make this as well. So
yeah, the thing about that is that they used, when she used to cook, she didn't have the white flour. She had the natural flour, because they used to go to the grinding mills in San Luis and get the flour, and it was brown, it was natural, it wasn't bleached like this is.
Can you tell me a little bit about the area of the San Luis Valley in Colorado? It's very interesting there, given that its geographical location and proximity also with New Mexico. So yeah. What we see are quite a few mixing of traditions.
Yeah, you know, for many years, San Luis is and sort of is still considered part of New Mexico. The early settlers came in from New Mexico about 1853 when they settled over there in New Mexico. I mean, in the San Luis Valley, and then they branched out from there. My mom's family is actually from the La Vida Pass area, which is just right as you enter into the San Luis Valley. My great-grandfather was from Crestone, which is in the valley. And also I had some relations from Trinidad. So that whole area is really has a lot of Hispanic influence into it.
Thank you very much. So para que estamos viendo también en español, lo que tenemos son, ¿cuántos tazas? How many cups of flour did you first add?
6. Tenemos 6.
6 tazas de harina con un poquito de sal, y ahorita vamos a agregar our next ingredient is...
It's sugar. Okay, and we got 2 cups of sugar right here.
Tenemos 2 tazas de azúcar.
And then 1 tazo here of brown sugar, packed.
So una taza de azúcar morena para agregar con el azúcar blanca.
And I'm just going to break that up.
too daunting.
Y lo que estaba hablando Ron hace ratito es que él, su familia viene de una área del sur de Colorado que se llama el Valle de San Luis, que fue una de las comunidades primer establecido por los españoles y tiene mucha influencia de allí con las comunidades también de Nuevo México.
I'm going to take and put in here about 2 teaspoons of anise into about 3/4 cup of water.
Entonces lo que se va a agregar siguiente es 2 cucharadas de anís con un poquito de agua. How much water did you say again?
3/4 cup.
3/4 agua.
So we got 2 teaspoons of anise, and we're going to put this on the stove just to simmer. You don't want to boil it, but you want to simmer it so that the anise flowers.
Oh, very nice. So what we have here is tenemos el anís dentro del agua y lo que vamos a tenerlo es en un lumbre bajito para que se hierve un poquito para que se abre el anís.
Anise is the special ingredients in bizcochitos. Bizcochitos actually go back to Spain. There's a cooking in Spain called bizcochos, and that's an anise cookie. So when the Spaniards came over into Mexico and up into New Mexico, they brought the recipe of bizcochos with them. So that's actually a really old Spanish recipe, bizcochos.
Este tipo de galleta que estamos haciendo aquí es, se llama bizcochitos, que es una receta muy antigua que viene desde con los españoles porque contiene anís. Y ellos hacían un tipo de bizcocho que se llama, o galleta que se llama bizcocho.
Okay, now to the sugar mixture, we're going to add 2 cups of lard, manteca.
And the lard has to be
melted
down.
Yeah,
okay,
melted
so
down.
2 tazas de manteca ya.
Yeah, and this is a 1/2 cup, so I'm putting 4 of these in there. In the old days, they used to use bacon drippings because they used to like the taste of the bacon drippings in there.
I'm sure that gave it a very nice flavor.
Yeah, you know, and then the old days, they used to use the buffalo fat, the manteca from the
tallow
from the buffalo.
So lo que puedes agregar en vez de manteca, también hay algunas personas que le gustan cocinar con tocino, también la manteca de tocino, o bisonte. En días antiguamente usaban manteca de bisonte.
So we're just creaming this together. You know, I bought my mom a real fancy Sunbeam KitchenAid blender. She never used it.
Never?
She always used her hands. And that's how abuelitas are. You're never going to see them using fancy mixing things. They're always going to use their hands.
Did you always assist your mother and grandmother in...
Somewhat. I really didn't know my grandmother. They died before I was born. But I used to assist my mom all the time. And she wanted to make sure that all of her kids knew how to cook.
Oh, nice.
Okay, now we're going to add 4 eggs.
So, agregamos después de la manteca 4 huevos.
Some recipes only go 2 eggs, but I go 4.
Okay. So, hay una variación donde uno puede tener 2 huevos, pero para la receta de la familia de Ramiera, él agrega 4 huevos. Are there some other traditional types of dishes that you remember from the San Luis Valley that your grandmother or mother has shared with you?
Almost everything that I really cook, arroz con pollo, you know, around this time we do the empanadas, the mincemeat empanadas.
Oh, nice. Can you tell me a little bit about the mincemeat empanadas?
The secret to the mincemeat empanadas, of course, is the sweet dough that you make. When you make the dough, you make it almost like a tortilla dough, but you also add a couple eggs into it to make as a binder, and then you add sugar to it also. That makes it sweet.
Oh, nice.
And then you also add a little bit of vanilla. And then since they used to use mincemeat, which is just pork or lengua that they cook, and then they grind that up, and you add your raisins, you add your nuts. If you're real fancy, you add the piñón. If you're willing to give up some piñón to do that.
Piñón is also a very regional item as well, correct?
Oh yeah, especially this year because this was the year that they had piñón in southern Colorado. I know out on my aunt's ranch and they were out there like crazy almost every weekend picking. It's a hard process to pick it, but it's really worth it.
Can you tell me a little bit about the tradition of people picking piñon? And I know even actually in Pueblo, while I was there this past weekend, there was a gentleman that came in and was very, he's like, I have piñon.
Oh yeah, everybody watches, and it comes every 4 years. That's when the tree blossoms. And then in that fourth year, if there isn't a lot of water, then you're not going to get a lot of piñon. The trees actually bloom every year, but they don't produce piñon every year. It's only every 4 years. But if there's a drought or something, then the piñon isn't going to go. And we go out there and you spend the whole day out there on your hands and knees picking it.
Oh.
It's a lot of work, but it's worth it. Okay, now I'm going to add 1 cup of milk. Now, some recipes, instead of milk, you add liquor. I know my mom used to make some biscochitos just for my Uncle Bill, and she used to use whiskey.
Whiskey?
Yeah, he'd bring her some whiskey, and she put a cup of whiskey just for him in the biscochitos. So she'd make a big batch just for him of the whiskey biscochitos.
Oh, nice. So lo que acaba de agregar Ron es una taza de leche, y también nos está compartiendo un poquito de su historia, de que su mamá también, si le gusta, puede agregar una taza también de whisky, que eso era un tipo de sus galletas favoritos de uno de sus tíos. Entonces, los que están viéndonos ahora en vivo, estamos parte del Smithsonian Latino Virtual Museum with Ron Miera, who is making bizcochitos. So I see that you're folding and stirring quite a bit in there.
Yeah, you want to get it as smooth as possible.
And making sure also that the manteca doesn't congeal, right?
Right.
Being that we're in Colorado, it is a little chilly out here, so room temperature too is also quite important.
Did I add the sugar? I was like, what? I was talking about the sugar, and I got, let's add that sugar. I can do it. Okay. Yeah, because I just added the, okay.
You added the brown sugar, and you told us how many.
Yeah. Okay, because I'm like, wait a second, I got 2 cups of sugar here. I don't want to screw up the recipe.
No, we need the sugar.
That's what makes it, is the sugar.
So could you tell us a little bit about, also while you're mixing this, how did you learn the tradition of being an artist, a santero?
I was looking at my Spanish genealogy, and my 7th grade grandfather was Captain Don Bernardo Miera y Pacheco. He was a santero, an explorer, and one of the very last Spanish to come into New Mexico. Let me get this here. This is the anise. You don't want to boil it.
So I'm going to add that. Oh, it smells very fragrant.
Yeah, anise is the secret. But anyway, by doing my genealogy research and finding out what a santero was, because he was, I started looking at it, and kind of funny because I would go to New Mexico and go to the churches all the time, not really realizing what I was looking at, the signs. So once I started researching it and finding out what he did and everything, that's when I decided, well, you know, I can do this too, try to keep on the tradition. But it's not something that you can just jump into. If you really want to be traditional about it, you got to ask about it, you got to get the books, got to do the research, and that's still ongoing on the research.
Mm-hmm.
But I love it though. Okay, mm-hmm. Now I'm going to fold in the flour.
Ahora agregamos las 6 tazas de harina. I have to say, from this side, it smells beautiful.
Yeah, it's the anise. Bizcochitos are called what they call Chicano love cookies. And one of the reasons is that anise has a property in it that helps women with their menstrual cycle. It also helps women, for some reason, really love licorice, and that's the main ingredient in licorice, black licorice, is anise. And they found out that it really helps women with a lot of their problems. There's a tea, a traditional tea that the Hispanic settlers used to make out of anise for women that had problems with their menstrual cycle. They'd make a special tea with the anise, and that helped them out.
Oh, nice. I was not aware of that.
And like I said earlier, that bizcochitos were made at weddings and funerals and every little occasion there was, for Christmas, for Easter. So that's another reason they're called love cookies, because they're made with love, at times of great love in the family.
Oh, what a beautiful story. Lo que acaba de explicar Ron es que este tipo de bizcocho le dicen Chicano, pues bizcocho de Chicano amor, porque
Lo que hay un ingrediente, el anís, que ayuda muchas veces a las mujeres con su ciclo de menstruación, pero particularmente cuando este bizcocho está servido es durante la temporada de bodas, de bautizo o temporada de mucho amor. Por eso también es su apodo es el Chicano Love Cookie.
Now I'm stirring it by hand, but my mom would just put her hand right in there like all of our abuelitas would do. She'd just put her mano right in there and just mix it by hand. So I'm not doing that because I'm not like that. Like I said, you know, I bought my mom a fancy mixer and she never used it.
But do you prefer or see a difference when the bizcochos are made by masando by hand or by spoon versus when it's made with the machine?
I don't think so, but you know, it's all on the preference and the cook, how the cook wants it to come out. You know, it's hands-on, and I think that's just something, you know, just like tortillas, you know, it's when you start making tortillas, nobody makes them round right away. It takes years and years to make a perfect round tortilla by hand. So, and if you, you know, use a tortilla press, that's cheating. You gotta do it by hand, the little patitas.
Yeah. So there's no cheating on this one. You
no.
prefer to do it with a spoon.
Yeah. Well, just because I don't want my hands all full.
Yeah.
Now, because the lard was warm, your cookie dough is really soft. So what you got to do is chill it. After you mix it in there really good, you have to chill the cookie dough.
And how long do you chill the cookie dough?
Usually about 20 minutes. You want to chill it so that it sets up and you're able to work with it. You don't want to keep adding more flour to it because if you keep adding more flour, the cookies will get tougher. The more flour you add, the tougher they come out. And you don't want a tough cookie.
Mm-hmm.
So this is pretty good mixed here. So I'm just going to go ahead and put this in the refrigerator.
And how much cookies does this recipe yield?
This recipe makes a lot, and it depends on how thick you want them. If you want a really thin cookie, you roll it really thin. If you want a thick cookie, you roll it thick. I usually are in halfway. You know, I do like to make them thick. That way you can dunk them into your coffee and they won't break apart on you. So this recipe will make about 9 dozen.
9 dozen.
Yeah.
So that's 6 cups of flour.
6 cups of flour, 2 cups of sugar.
1 cup of brown sugar.
Excuse me. Pinch of salt, 5 teaspoons of baking powder. Let's see, we got the 4 eggs, 1 cup of milk, and the 2 cups of lard. And the anise, 2 teaspoons of the anise with the 3/4 cups of the water.
Okay. So, all right, so we're going to put that into the refrigerator to chill.
Okay, so this morning I made some dough here. That way we'd have some and we didn't have to wait around. I love this time of year. Everybody's making cookies and giving cookies. Enough flour down and they don't stick to the surface. And then we got a tile surface here at chalk, so it's kind of a little difficult here.
Okay.
Make a couple more puffles in the oven.
And you said that this recipe yields about 9 dozen, right?
9 dozen. Okay, before we put them into the oven, we're going to take some sugar. And put some cinnamon in the sugar. I guess about two parts sugar to 1 part cinnamon. That sounds about right. I like a lot of cinnamon. I love cinnamon. And we're just going to sprinkle this on top of the biscuit chicos. Sprinkle it on there. Be generous. And these will puff up in the oven.
So could you also use brown sugar if you preferred, or is it always white sugar and cinnamon?
It's always white sugar and cinnamon.
Okay.
Yeah. You can put, you know, your fancy red and green sprinkles on there too, but it's just not the same. That's not biscochito.
You're like, that's not the biscochito recipe.
Yeah, that's sugar cookies. Okay, and then you put these in the oven for about 11 minutes.
Oh, only 11 minutes?
Yeah.
So you have it at a heat at 350, as you said.
350 degrees.
Okay. So while we're waiting for that, do you mind maybe if we repeat a little bit of the overall recipe? So just to start again, to as a kind of a review for our viewers.
Sure. Okay, you're going to shift 6 cups of flour with five teaspoons of baking powder, not baking soda, baking powder, and then put in a dash of salt. You're going to mix that up together, sift it together, put that to the side, and then you're going to get a cup and a half of sugar, white sugar. You're going to add a cup of brown sugar. To that, you're going to add 2 cups of lard. And then what else do we add to that? I'm sorry. And then you add the 4 eggs. After you mix that all together, you cream that all together. You add a cup of milk, cream it all together. Then you're going to add your anise. Your anise is going to be on the stove. You're going to add 3/4 cup of water with 2 teaspoons of anise. Let that blossom on the stove, you know, and then add that to that. And then add in your flour mixture. Mix it all together and then roll it up.
Nice. Thank you so much. And so we still have a lot of dough there that I see.
Yeah.
But I think for the sake of time, we have some bizcochos, right? That
yeah,
have
bizcochitos. Yeah, they're around here somewhere.
So once again, you're here watching the Smithsonian Latino Virtual Museum with Ron Mieira of Denver, Colorado, sharing his family recipes of bizcochitos.
Yeah, there we go. These ones I made earlier in the morning when I made that dough. So they're all ready to eat. Get your coffee ready.
Which we have here.
Yeah.
So I just want to say, are there any other kind of recipe secrets or tips that you would be willing to share with us about making the bizcochitos?
No, that's about it. I pretty much said everything that there is to do about bizcochitos. Like I said, everybody has their own different methods. My buddy Sean here, his mom would roll them out into a log, freeze it, and then cut them so you make these little tiny bizcochitos. My favorite place to get bizcochitos is in New Mexico, in Chimayo. There's a weaving shop there, the Ortega's gift shop and weaving shop there, and they sell bizcochitos year-round there. And I think they're like $3 for $1, and I always go in there and buy $5 worth, and I'm happy for the rest of my trip into New Mexico. So I have those bizcochitos there.
As long as you have those particular ones. Oh, great. Well, thank you so very much for sharing your family recipe here with us.
Uh-huh.
You have been participating and part of the Smithsonian Latino Virtual Museum Latino Holiday Series. Thank you all very much, and we greatly appreciate it. Thank you.
Right.